Hello and welcome to The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Rakhee, Bakshee. In this show, we keep talking to leading personalities. And the personality with us today is a very interesting personality. He's come all the way from Japan. He's Mr. Yohei SasaKawa. He's also the chairman of Nippon Foundation, also Goodwill Ambassador for the Leprosy Foundation. And welcome to India, first of all, Mr. SasaKawa.
Thank you.
And we would like to really welcome you here in our country. How do you feel being here in India?
Well, every time I come maybe I've been here 40 times over the last 10 years. And every time I come, what I notice is that the cities are constantly developing. And I not only stay in the cities, but I also go into the rural areas. And there I also see the same phenomenon, and I see that the whole country is becoming more and more energetic and very much developed.
And as you're visiting rural areas in India here, you are talking about a very noble cause, and you're talking about people here who are suffering from a disease called leprosy. And this is exactly what you're looking at as to how their suffering can be lessened. And your foundation actually is working to make them more aware about the disease and how they can be cured and how they can have a respectable life altogether. Mm. So tell us more about this whole process that you're involved in.
Well, leprosy is a disease that has existed from very, very olden times, and it is a very long time, that it has also been accompanied by discrimination. I think, as far as we know, it's probably the oldest in humankind and the most tragic disease, because once you contract with leprosy, people treat you as an outcast. You lose your human dignity, and this is a suffering that accompanies this disease. This did not happen only in India, it happened all over the world. And it is called the disease of a terrible tragedy. Of course, in normal diseases, once you're cured, you're freed of this. Nobody talks about you, nobody discriminates you. Leprosy is different. There is a disease within our own society that is called stigma and discrimination. So, modern medicine can cure the disease, and the medication for leprosy is free of charge all over the world. And so the main point of my activity is to improve the standard of living of these people, and also that they are accepted back into society so that they can actually live as all of us do. I'm focusing my work here in India because 70% or close to 70% of the world patients reside here in India.
Yeah, in fact, it is something interesting that you're working on in terms of, looking at our social issues. But talking about India, public health is a big issue, and this is a matter of concern for us. And the way that you're looking at leprosy, what are your thoughts about, how we should be doing much more better in terms of our health issues? And if your country or you yourself are looking at some diverse areas to kind of help us here in India?
Well, there are many issues when you talk about health issues, but one of the major problems in health area is infectious diseases. Leprosy is also an infectious disease, but of course the infectiousness is not that strong, but it is one of the infectious diseases. When we look at the modern world today, of course, the standard of life has changed all over the world, and the lifestyle of people are changing, so the types of diseases that people get contracted seem to be changing as well. For example, obesity, hypertension, and maybe diabetes or cardiovascular diseases are the types of diseases that people are suffering today. In other words, diseases are expanding more and more to other areas as well. Seeing this sort of a situation in the world, I feel that education is very, very important. To teach the youngsters while they are still in the young age about what nutrition is all about, what health is all about, and what it is to live a happy, healthy life that must be taught at schools. But on the other hand, when we look at our own country, Japan, because our health education has been so thoroughly spread throughout the country, we do have people over the age of 100 years old to be 59,000. So this sort of a problematic society also should be reviewed as well.
So you're talking about education, how it can also help in, reducing such, diseases as such, and it also helps in spreading awareness more and more. But let's talk about the two countries and how India and Japan as two countries are coming together. Our Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, visited Japan, and both India and Japan have been now committed to help each other. Japan, in fact, has promised to help in many ways. Would you like to talk about this whole strong, energetic partnership that India and Japan have today?
Well, when Prime Minister Modi visited Japan, I had the opportunity to meet him, and I was also able to take part in the official banquet that was held by the Japanese government. I feel that he is a man with a halo above his head, and I think he is one of the world leaders, and he should be really a very, very strong and influential leader in the world. Well, I would just like to move on to talk about the India-Japan relationship, as you have mentioned. And I would like the viewers of this television program to listen to me and to understand how our friendship has been built. We have a very long and important history between our two countries, because Japan in those years, in the relationship with the international community, there was really very much activity in the private sector. And of course, as you probably know, the India-Japan Association now is 105 years old. And of course, Tagore, your very famous Nobel Prize laureate from West Bengal, and an artist in Japan, Okakura Kazuzo, were the two, I would say, literary men that actually started to build this friendly relationship between the two countries. Now, 70 years ago, there was a World War II going on throughout the world. And of course, Japan wanted to see the Indian independence very strongly, that India should become an independent in this battle. And there was a gentleman called Bihar Bose, who was a distinguished independence fighter. And this man was actually exiled in Japan. And while he was in exile, he thought very seriously of how India could become an independent country. Now, there is an episode with Mr. Bihar Bose, and that is that he married a young girl from a very, very old noble family of Japan. And actually, they built a restaurant or shop that, and he taught, Mr. Bose taught the Japanese how to make curry. In fact, he imported curry into Japan. And today, of course, one of the most popular food is the curry rice that we have in Japan.
Yeah. Another question I would like to ask you here. You have talked about this whole warm relationship that both India and Japan have. Let's talk about another issue which is very important here in India now, and Prime Minister Modi is taking particular interest in this issue, which is of sanitation, how to maintain good hygiene in India. And I'm sure there also Japan is looking at, because it's looking at making India better in terms of building smart cities and many other such programs. So how would you talk about that?
Well, in Japan, from the olden days, we have what we call the 5S movement. And I think Prime Minister Modi is doing that himself to spread that in your country. And of course, the younger people today might not know of these 5S's, but they take the S's from Japanese words. And one is tidiness, the other one is cleanliness, okay, and then the other one is sanitation, and the fourth one is sweeping, cleaning, and also the last very important one is discipline. And of course, I myself, when I have time, I do clean around the house, or I do broom around my garden. And it's normal that we Japanese carry brooms around the house to keep the house tidy and clean.
Yeah, and another question that I asked you is also about Japan's promise of giving us help in terms of making smarter cities here in India. You've already helped us with the metro system here, which is functioning very well. But talk about this whole project on making smart cities. In fact, Mr. Modi's own constituency, Varanasi, is now going to be modeled on Kyoto Plan, which is a city there in Japan. So talk about that also.
Well, unfortunately, I'm not very knowledgeable about this topic that you have just mentioned about the smart city. But I would like to mention one thing while the metro was being built here in India. What everybody was impressed was because the Japanese workers were here, and they would all go to work. The Indian workers would go to work and see that the Japanese workers were already ready to go to work at 9 o'clock sharp. So the Minister of Transport came one day and said to the Indian workers, you must be there on time at 9 o'clock. So the next day the Indian workers went, and then the Japanese workers were already there. And they questioned them to say, why do you come so early? And the Japanese workers said, we're starting work at 9 o'clock, and therefore we need time to prepare. And so we come before 9 o'clock and prepare so that we will be able to start our work from 9 o'clock sharp. This is a very famous story that took place while the metro was being built. Okay.
No, that's a great success story, in fact, the metro here. But there are other economic projects. But taking a cue from the whole economic cooperation, you are very particular about helping small farmers. So there is this whole agriculture technology that you're helping some of the African countries also with. So talk about this whole new era of farming where, even the lower rung of farmers are also helped. And that's how agriculture should grow and progress.
Hi.
Well, I feel that, of course, the world now will be facing a food shortage for sure when the population reaches 7 million, and that is not far in the future. And therefore, in order to eradicate poverty, I feel that we must look at the farming sector. In India, many people are small-scale farmers, and of course, it is very, very important that their standard of life is raised. Of course, there is the issue of urban poverty, but because majority of people here in India are farmers, we must be able to increase their yield and production capacity so that they will be able to sell their product to the market and get cash income. Now, most of them are very badly nutritioned and the balance is very bad. So should they be able to sell their products at the market in exchange for cash, I feel that it would be able to improve their health balance, nutrition balance as well. And I feel that this is a solution to poverty in India and elsewhere.
Okay. So there are many such interesting points and issues that we would like to really talk to you about, Mr. SasaKawa. Mm-hmm. But right now we are taking a very short break here on our program, The Quest. And I must tell you, viewers, that though Mr. SasaKawa is speaking in Japanese and it's being translated, it's been very interesting hearing his views. And he has a range of views on subjects that matter to India here and how Japan is looking at India and helping India. So right now we are taking a very short break here on The Quest, but we'll keep talking to Mr. SasaKawa even after this very short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to The Quest. You're watching here this conversation with Mr. Yohei SasaKawa. He's the chairman of Nippon Foundation, but somebody who's socially very aware and also working for the people who are suffering from leprosy here and also working on many such social issues. But talking about, all these social sectors that you're looking at culturally, Buddhism is a strong link between the two countries. Japan is looking at that also. So any thought on that you'd be sharing with us? Also, this whole educational exchange that India and Japan have, would you like to throw some light on that also, sir?
Hi.
Well, when it comes to higher education, I personally have been involved with the Nehru University and also Jadavpur University in Calcutta for the last 20 years, and especially providing endowment in the master's and PhD courses. I am very proud of the students that have actually studied under my program and that they are really distinguished students that we have had over the past decades. And of course, the Japanese universities are now looking forward into the international community and how we can build international relationship. Some of the Japanese universities already have Indian offices here in India, and they are really trying to have excellent Indian students go and study in Japan as well. So when we come to talk about the primary education in the primary school level, of course, with the popularization of the IT technology from India, there are schools in Tokyo built by the Indian community for the primary school pupils. And especially because the Indian children are so good in arithmetic, that it is very popular with the young mothers of the Japanese children to send their children to these Indian schools, even from the primary school age.
You know, since you talked about education, another question which is linked to it is also how Japan, of course, in terms of high technology, is helping India with, in terms of automobile sector or in terms of all these gadgets and technically advanced machines that you're helping us with. Talk about this whole relationship of taking technology to a greater level.
Now, I did not have time to continue when I was talking a little bit about history a while ago, but the, of course, Japan has played a big influence on the independence of India. And because there was a gentleman, not Mr. Bihar Bose, but Mr. Chandra Bose, who is called the father of Indian independence. While he was in Germany, Fujiwara Iwaichi, who was a Japanese, brought him from Germany to Singapore in a submarine. And at that time, of course, Japan was fighting the British Army, and there were 50,000 Indian prisoners taken by the British Army. And the 50,000 prisoners were released, and what Mr. Fujiwara did was actually to make them all into the members of the Indian National Army. And they took the army together and went to India through Imphal. And that was where the seed of the Indian independence was planted. And I feel that the Japanese man has played such an important role in this, bringing Chandra Bose from Germany to finally end up in the independence of India. We have a bilateral relationship that is indivisible. It is something that can never be broken again. It is so very strong.
Okay. And despite all this modern technology here, globally, all around, you know, we are talking about peace and we are talking about security all over the world. You yourself have talked a lot about how maritime security and building peace all around the world. But how you're looking at, you know, this whole effort towards disarmament, which is again a global issue. We are all looking at reducing weapons, creating more peace and love.
Well, of course, we are not talking about whether it is possible or whether it is impossible. We all have an obligation to take action, to do it, because we cannot leave this unattended to for our children, for our grandchildren, for the generations to follow. If we're going to build a peaceful planet here on Earth and to leave it to them, it is all of us here living on this planet today that even though there are so many issues on hand, that we are strictly responsible, and we have a huge obligation to solve this problem to leave the peaceful Earth for the next generations.
Okay, and two, three questions, in fact, that I would like to mix into one also. We here in India are talking about there is one government, and then there is a society, and then there are people who are trying to create a link and how to make this whole world better, or whole cities or governments or nations better. So how do you think government's role should be in building up a better society, and how do you think the civil society can come together with the government to build a better nation?
Well, that's, your questions are becoming more and more difficult, but let me just answer to that. I feel personally that the economic and politics of this world cannot be just bundled up in one package called the democracy. I think democracy should be diverse democracy depending on what each nation's history is or culture is or tradition is. We must respect those elements then to make a democracy that is fit for every nation. So we must have not a common, a single democracy as defined in the world, but really diverse democracy. Well, let's take Japan as an example. Of course, I feel that Japan is a country with very advanced democracy. Yet the politicians, therefore, when they want to really answer to what the populace wants to do, they really go into a very big financial deficit. This is a result when you listen to the things that the people want to do, and the politicians feel that it is their role to answer to them. The solution, the result is a financial deficit. And therefore, I feel that populism leads eventually to the downfall of a country if it goes too far. So I feel that the leadership in a democracy must be able to take the country onwards by listening to the public and the civil society's voices, and yet to have the courage to even go on with what they believe is the right direction, even if there are objections from the civil society. I feel that the politicians need courage to go and fulfill their own objective.
I'm sure this is a very, very interesting thought there coming from you, Mr. Sasakawa. But I must also talk about women here in India. And in fact, globally, we are trying for more respect for women all around. Any thoughts on that that you would like to share?
Well, I think what you have mentioned is obvious of the obvious, because I feel that, of course, particularly here in Asia, this is a maternal society, and the women must therefore be respected, and they are being respected. For example, when I go home, I have no authority in the home, starting from a small unit, and all the authority has been taken by my wife. So, but yet I feel that the women are really object of respect, and they must be respected. And I feel that for women to be active in the society is really the major element of building our democratic society.
As we are ending, and this quick final question, and answer it very briefly, is that what's your plan here, Mr. Sasakawa? Socially, you're doing so much. You've already talked about helping those patients who are suffering from leprosy. But if there is any other plan, talk about that also very briefly as we are wrapping up the program.
Well, I talked with His Holiness the Dalai Lama yesterday, and also what I talked to him about is that I will also have no more leprosy-affected patients in India, and also that there will be no stigma and discrimination that is really bringing about tragedy to these people. And I also said that I shall have not a single leprosy-affected person be begging on the streets. I am 75 years old now, and this will be the major mission and the life work that I still have to fulfill.
And thank you so much for being here in India and talking to us on Rajya Sabha TV. It was a pleasure talking to you, Mr. Sasakawa.
Thank you so much. We really value your time that
you've given to us. And that was Mr. Sasakawa of Nippon Foundation. He has come all the way from Japan, as we said, and he's here in India. He has a very noble thought to work for those who suffer from leprosy. But apart from that, he's working on many other such social issues. It was very interesting talking to us, and we thank him for being here. Once again, thank you for watching this program, The Quest, on Rajya Sabha TV. Namaskar and bye-bye.